Of course, that's the true persecution. Of course, the same thing with Islam. We think that now there's a lot of brothers running over to Islam as if that's the counterplay, but they both are ruled by Rome. Islam is run by Rome. In fact, I was telling you last time, yes, because it was the Pope who gave permission to Islam to be practiced here on the continent of the United States after the conquest of the Moors. And you know that all of the so-called patriarchs of Christianity are in Islam. And the same patriarchs are in Judaism. So it's these three that are causing the madness and the grief that we're suffering from on the planet. And of course, there's going to be brothers that says, no, it's not, that's not true Islam. Of course, it's not true Islam. Just like this isn't true Christianity. But many people are being murdered in that name.
Now, a lot of people wonder why you talk so much about Christianity. Mm-hmm. But I also, I give you a reference that you started out as almost becoming a priest.
Mm-hmm.
So you studied all this.
I did.
Right? Mm-hmm. So you're a product of
the Roman Church.
Of a Christian upbringing.
The Roman Church, yes.
And you found out through your early training, mm-hmm, that they were feeding you nothing but lies.
Lies. And the thing is, it's not even a lie. It's more insidious than a lie. It's the lie that's sugar-coated with parts of the truth. So, you know, you say that's a spoonful of sugar may help the medicine go down. Well, to get you to deal with the bitterness of this lie, they had to sugarcoat it with some of the truth. So it was easy for you to get past your palate, but once it was in your stomach, it's already done the damage. It's been doing the damage to our minds as people. When religion dies, humanity rises as a total species of consciousness, because spirituality is lost in religion. Religion becomes a technical basis for your belief structuring only, not your spiritual awareness.
Okay.
Because religion makes you dependent, whereas spirituality creates your independence.
Because of all the devils in the church.
Oh, the devils in the church. Essentially, a church is a body. It's just simply another word for body. Now, isn't the body of man, wouldn't Jesus Christ call the Son of Man? Then if that's the case, then he was the son of a collective, not the son of one God. And if he was also the son of man, that meant man is God.
Let's go back to the time when humanity was called Saptapana. Saptapana was man plant. The atmosphere was very much hyperhydrogenated. It was a complex hydrogen energy. You'll understand that as we go back in time to the one Atum, as Dr. Oyibo speaks about, there was only one element. The compounding of element is the multiplication of the one. So when you see one, then the next one, helium is two hydrogen atoms. And you go along the periodic table, it's all the addition of different qualities of helium, of hydrogen, being the one thing, manifesting as the many. As man began to consolidate around a particular projected form, it brought with it all of the atomic energies that it needed, consolidated into different forms that it took in order to consolidate the body we have right now. As man condensed into denser and denser atmospheres, into the envelope that we had, it did not bring an appetite with it, because the place it came from had no appetite. It was the one thing. In fact, it gave more than it needed to take back. As man consolidated deeper and deeper into the levels of matter, it finally found certain envelopes that matched the different frequency levels as it became denser and denser. So man actually is not evolved. Man is a condensed energy. It's a condensing or a threshing out from inside out until solidification came to be. Now, that sunlight, that one dot, that one point where everything emanated from, has points all over to reference itself. And I told you one time that God is a point that can be found everywhere, a center, a point everywhere, and whose circumference is nowhere. So the point that you see us as now is essentially the consolidated one finding itself as the many. Now, why am I talking about that? Because the origin of the vampires and all the different ways that you see it happen there, all happen is a disjointed story from different pieces that everybody got a little piece of the puzzle, but nobody has brought it together to show you what really happened. The reason why I'm taking you back to the time how man came into being, I don't have the time to give you all the different pieces. I'm nutshelling it as man condenses. Just like, to give up, for instance, for the people, just as water vapor through densification, molecular densification becomes water. You come from the invisible realm into water, liquid, and then under conditions of vibration, because all things are waves and vibratory, as vibrations begin to slow from the higher realms to the low, they're solid. So you go from vapor, liquid, to solid. That is the process of man. In fact, that is the process of all creation. It is a condensing solidification process. As man came, and they talked about the breathing of the soul in it, the breathing of the soul, the breathing of the spirit into man is the breathing of the intent. And intent had to create itself as polarity. The breath is the representation of polarity, yin yang. Every time you breathe in, there's a spot. Take in, dip it out, there's a spot. So that's the point where you see the breath, the black and the white. Where you breathe in the black, there's still the white. That's the space. As you breathe out, you see the black. That's the space. You see the white. So everything is manifesting to keep a balance. Okay. As man began to become more and more solidified in that realm, the principle of darkness, or the principle of invisibility, is black. Okay, when you can't see something, that too is black. I don't care if you can see all the light. The lack of ability to see that is darkness. So as man began to become consolidated into form, the best absorber or the best retainer for the body was the blackness. So that container that you see, the blue blackness, was the original man as the original processor of the purity of light. Okay, so that blue-black person, in fact, the blue-black person was not in the desert. The blue-black person that you see was actually in the rainforest. So if the rainforest has this huge canopy, where was the sunlight to keep this man blue-black? Unless the man was already blue-black when he came and came down as the original being inside of it. They say, well, all the plants and everything were all there. Yeah, all the plants and everything were there waiting for him, all the animals. Because those were the representative expressions of thoughts. Everything that is alive is the representative residual of thought. So as man began to consolidate itself, and in that consolidation experienced his environment, he began to process it as an experience through what he thought, as thinking. Mind became thought. And these residuals began putting it down. And why am I doing all this? Because you'll understand what happened and what cut us off. As man began to become consolidated into civilizations, there were civilizations that were not civilizations. There were no laws that man made in order for man to be. Man left the body and came in the body. Man took it anytime he wanted, left it when he wanted it. There was no consolidated process of seasons and so forth to match the disruption of the waveform. Consciousness is restricted awareness. So as man began to become more and more conscious of itself, it had to restrict itself from the one thing. So the more restriction it made, the more it needed to know about itself, it created that. As man began to formulate itself amongst different bands, there was a disturbance, some kind of destruction from that sameness, because anything that creates in life, that creates an environment where everything is too stable, nothing progresses. The part that man has created, the part that is intent, the part of the seed of chaos is what it's called. The seed of chaos is implanted in every living entity, because if it wasn't there, the entity wouldn't strive to perfect itself. There is always a disturbance in perfection in order for perfection not to die within its own perfection. Okay, so as that happens, as man began to proceed deeper into the realms of matter, matter now showed that it needed all forms of experience and all forms of interfacing of the mind in order for it to be spiritualized. For matter to be spiritualized, the human form had to become more inventive in order to process the seeds of thought into spirit. In other words, this is a potential spirit. All this is an agreement to be. Once we stop agreeing with this, then we no longer are part of this agreement, and therefore we move forward. There are entities who chose, who at this time in humanity, we were just out there just thinking and making things happen. There were entities that came and said, you're not supposed to do that. Let's just say that, because I can't get as deep in them, want to, because we can go along. You're not supposed to do that. This is where in humanities, all along the planet, you get these things where man was perfect and was tempted. Well, man was co-opted, because there were different entities, and okay, we got to go back to the point where there's a form of creation that is based upon another form of creation rather than coming from the direct source. The direct source are first level entities, then there's second level entities that belong to the residuals that I talked about, the animal plane. Well, there are residuals that come from higher forms of life that have a living consciousness that can interface with us right now, and you would think that they were human beings, but they were not. Okay, there's so much to talk about in so little time. So I'm bringing as much as I can in this. Now, here we have man in its descent into matter, and the story of man's descent into matter is all in the Bible, all in the Sefer Yetzirah, all in the different form, all in the book of coming forth by day. All of the heavy books are about man's descent into matter and man's ascent out of matter.
In fact, today, if you were to go to Africa and talk to the children who've been Christianized, they will tell you that their ancestors covenanted with devils, and this is why black people are in the condition they are today. So turn to Christianity, and of course you turn to the oppressor's religion, and then you eat the gruel that they give you, and at the bottom it says Jesus saved you. Of course, you're conditioning that person for another 1,000 years.
Adventurous guests, of course, cannot opt for our jungle river cruise or for a close-up look at our majestic...
None of these attractions are ready yet, of course, but the park will open with the basic tour you're about to take. And then other rides will come online 6 or 12 months after that. Absolutely spectacular design, spared no expense.
And we can charge anything we want, $2,000 a day, $10,000 a day, and people will pay it. And then there's the merchandise. I can personally...
Donald.
This park was not built to cater only for the super rich. Everyone in the world has the right to enjoy these animals.
Sure, they will. I mean, what, we'll have a coupon day or something?
Yes. Gee, the lack of humility before nature that's being displayed here staggers me.
Well, thank you, Dr. Malcolm, but I think things are a little bit different than you and I had feared.
Yeah, I know, they're a lot worse.
Now, wait a second, now, we haven't even seen the park. Donald,
let him talk. There's no reason. No, I want to hear every viewpoint. I really do.
Yeah, don't you see the danger, John, inherent in what you're doing here? Genetic power is the most awesome force the planet's ever seen, but you wield it like a kid that's found his dad's gun.
It's hardly appropriate to start hurling generalizations.
If I may, I'll tell you the problem with the scientific power that you're using here. It didn't require any discipline to attain it. You know, you read what others had done, and you took the next step. You didn't earn the knowledge for yourselves, so you don't take any responsibility for it. You stood on the shoulders of geniuses to accomplish something as fast as you could, and before you even knew what you had, you patented it and packaged it and slapped it on a plastic lunchbox, and now you're selling it. You want to sell it. Well,
I don't think you're giving us our due credit. Our scientists have done things which nobody's ever done before.
Yeah, but your scientists were so preoccupied with whether or not they could that they didn't stop to think if they should.
Condors. Condors are on the verge of extinction. And if I was to create a flock of condors on this island, you wouldn't have anything to say.
No, hold on. This isn't some species that was obliterated by deforestation or the building of a dam. Dinosaurs had their shot, and nature selected them for extinction.
I simply don't understand this Luddite attitude, especially from a scientist. I mean, how can we stand in the light of discovery and not act?
Oh, what's so great about discovery? It's a violent, penetrative act that scars what it explores. What you call discovery, I call the rape of the natural world.
Now, I'm here in Texas, okay? I'm in East Texas. And one of the things that I find shocking, you know, and listening to yourself and Dr. Lalani speak on it, I notice there are women here that are not even 40 yet, and they're getting breast cancer. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember
some women
as young as 17
with breast cancer.
Oh, yeah, we've been getting children with
what?
Breast cancer.
Oh, my goodness.
We've got children with fibroid tumors, yeah. Remember the saying that in the last days and time, and this is in my book, in the last days and time, the young will be afflicted with the diseases of the old.
Wow.
And that's exactly what is happening. The rate and the velocity of degeneration is sped up, and it shows in every generation that generation is suffering. Not only are they going through radical puberty at a very young age, which is a sure sign of degeneration of the species, but
yeah,
that rapid puberty is leading to a faster and more accelerated forms of degeneration through children. For instance, women about 30 years of age are telling me they're having perimenopause. Already they're having menopausal conditions at mid-30s, which is ridiculous. You know, African women aren't supposed to be doing that. But because of the increased pollution, the increased water, the kinds of drugs that women are susceptible to, the birth control, all of these have accelerated, destroyed the female's inner biologies. And all of this essentially came about and began accelerating after 1960, when they began to introduce into the society all these different drugs that women were taking. In fact, now it's becoming so rampant that they're finding that estrogen from the urine of women taking these birth control pills cannot be filtered out through the aquifer in the water supply for the community. And estrogenic materials from women's urine are finding their way into the faucets, into the drinking water, into the water that we use to deal with bottled water, so that estrogenic materials, and that men, because of the high radiation that we live in today, the estrogenic material, men's estrogen receptor sites have become more stimulated. So we are taking in more estrogen, and we are causing a lot more diseases to men because they're not making and creating the proper amount of testosterone.
You can't bring a tennis racket to a soccer field. It doesn't, the whole issue was emotional. If she has something emotionally wrong with her, not intellectually wrong with her, that's why she has the fibroids. She has the emotional illness. And emotional illness may have been a family illness, like he was saying. It contributed to the whole condition. Because some people don't want to create children. So they shut down their creative element in itself. They're not using all their creativity. They're on a job they shouldn't be on. And the God's saying, you should be doing this. You should be using your creativity. So they shut down the creativity. So the emotions shut down the creative element. Not creating the right spirit you need to be in life. One year you're a Jehovah's Witness, next year you're Muslim, next year you're saying, job. Because you haven't created the spirit you need to live this life, and you're searching for your spirit. So you're shutting down your creativity, so you're shutting down the creative organ in your body. The man's not letting you be a man, he's treating you like a bitch. So that's shutting down your right to be human. If there's something wrong with the vagina and uterus, there's something wrong with the black nation. It's losing its creativity, its ability to be free. It's shut down. So the woman is expressing a problem with the whole damn race, and she's taking the blame for it. If she was free, and the only way to be free is to practice your culture at all times and in all situations, then you're free. But since the black nation itself is not free, it's shutting down its ability to create another calculus, another astronomy, another pyramid, another Marcus Garvey. You see what I'm talking about? And the reflection of that is the black woman's uterus. There's something wrong with our damn race, not the woman.
The whole key to the universe is balance. That's the yin and the yang coming together equally. You gotta come together in balance to complete the cycle and make the whole. You can't balance like this. You can't balance like that.
Two halves don't equal a whole.
Right. That's what two halves.
Don't equal a whole.
Right.
Gotta be two wholes coming together.
Or two halves.
Okay.
Two halves. This one half come together like this. But if you got one down here and one up here, they don't match. Okay. Or one down. So you can't go into a relationship thinking you're above and somebody's lower, or I'm lower and you're higher than me, which is what the black woman is going to look up to her man, because she's insecure about her value. Right. That's what Willie Lynch did to her. And then she's letting him define her value, which is her role to do. Okay, being the earth element.
Right.
Who's the master of values, you see. And then he can't come into the relationship in his ego thinking he's higher than her, you see. So you gotta both come together. Like, I'm bringing equal to the table, you're bringing equal to the table, and only then can we be a match for each other and complete the vortex or the cycle and open up that energy from the source of Mama Universe. Mm-hmm.
In a synchronicity that was essentially inevitable. And I say that too with Paul, because there are over a million men of color, Capitone, black men, missing in the United States of America that nobody knows where they are. Over a million. Where are they? They're not just in jail. They just completely disappeared off the grid. Nobody's paying attention to that. Yeah. And the thing about it is that a lot of us may have gone on the radar, but a lot of us may have gone someplace that we are still looking to find out where they are keeping us or where they have taken us, what they have done. But the fact that those of us who have been told that we need to fight one another, we need to be arbitrary with one another, need to be constantly in conflict with one another, that's the way they need to have us. Because that conflict, that need to separate, that need to constantly be in contention is what's keeping us from our power, and that is the collective strength. So when you said that you all essentially put down your swords, or at least sheathed your swords and not aimed it at each other anymore, you're back to that square one where we knew who the enemy was. We have lost sight of who the enemy really is. He has come in amongst us. He has come in amongst us, and he has infiltrated us. Not just us physically, but in our minds. And that's the place where he's conducting the war. And the war that he needs, and the first thing that Sun Tzu says, is that you must create separation. To fight a greater enemy, to fight a greater adversary, you must destroy them from within. You must undermine them. You must cause them to become separate. You must create different camps within the camp. And therefore, with that dissociation, with that confusion, you can conquer a greater enemy. They know what happens when we get together. That's why the number one tactic is to make sure that we stay apart. So that first step is symbolic of power, of the acquisition and the growth of power, which must be nurtured and it must be kept sacrosanct. It must not be something displayed. You must take it underground, no matter what the temptation, because that's where all things build. That's where all things actually are germinated, in the ground, underground. So you have to take it and keep it there. The best hip-hop is the one that's underground, and only those who know where to find it will go. And that's what we need to do. We need to keep it germinating in the soil of the underground. And that's exactly why we created the underground so many years ago, because that's the place where the real happens. And this is why we say this is where you are right now, Brother Paul. Bring the brothers back underground and keep your information secret amongst one another. Do not display it, do not keep constantly going out there and trying to get an audience with people who are not ready to understand and understand what it is you're imparting to them. It's only 1/10 of the people that's destroying this planet. 1/10 less than one-tenth of the people control and are destroying this planet. So can you imagine what one-tenth of us could do?
That's right.
I say